Thank you, everyone. So my name is Kai, and I do web and Android stuff. And what I would really encourage you to do is use my Twitter account to provide feedback during the talk, comments, questions, positive feedback, negative feedback, whatever you like. I come actually from down there. So for people who are further in the back and can't see where that is, it's New Zealand. I am from Germany originally and moved down to New Zealand a few years ago. And when you move to the other side of the world, you all of a sudden realize that time has interesting implications. Because you're literally in a time zone like 12 hours away from your old home or 10 hours away from your old home. And you can't just jump in a car and drive from Germany to France. You just fly 4 to 30 hours to get to places, basically. So let's have a quick chat about why I pitched this talk. The reason is, basically, I've got really weird friends, who some of them are in this room, like Miguel, and Anastasia, and Keddy, and Mitchell, and Lara, and Mario. And we are all part of the Android community, and we've been at a conference in Japan, Droid Kaigi, earlier this year. And we ended up playing Mario Kart on our Nintendo Switches there. So we liked that, and then we thought, hey, what about if we make that a weekly thing, like an online tournament? So this is us in Japan, actually, playing. So I set up an online tournament to happen on a Sunday morning for me, Saturday night in Europe, and we started playing. And then things started to happen, mainly daylight savings times. So New Zealand went into daylight savings time, or we went out of daylight savings time in March. Germany went into daylight savings time, and all of a sudden, people showed up for our online tournaments an hour too early, an hour too late, missed it. And it turns out that Nintendo, the global corporate doing gaming stuff, can't figure out time zones and daylight savings times properly. It's just ridiculous, basically. So I was so angry about that. I thought, like, it's 2018, let's talk about time zones and, in a bit of a wider context, locales as well. So here's some context. We actually live on one planet, and we're all happy little cats. And all those happy little cats, you know, have different characters, different scripts. We have different cultures. We have different times and time zones. We live in different locations. And we speak different languages to a good extent. And that makes it actually a quite large and complex scenario to build anything in. You know, servers, web applications, mobile applications, doesn't really matter. It's not trivial anymore. Some examples in that context. So when we talk about time, for example, we have time formats and time notations. We have time zones. We have daylight savings times. We have boundaries of time zones. And we'll focus on that in a few minutes. And then when it comes to languages, we have spoken language, written language. We have different scripts. We have, you know, like Western characters, Arabic characters, Asian characters, yada, 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 all those kind of things. We have reading directions, like left to right, right to left. We have translations. How do we deal with that kind of stuff? In the ecosystem of numbers, we've got decimal formats, like where do you put the comma and the dot? We have currency formats, and where do you put the currency symbol, depending on the language? So again, that's not a trivial thing. And from a more cultural point of view, we have stuff like the meaning of colors and symbols and artworks in a cultural context. Yeah? You might actually build something for a culture where red is really offensive, or where the number 13 is really offensive for whatever reason, right? And you need to be aware of those kind of things. Let's talk about terminology quickly. There are usually two terms that pop up all the time. One is I18N, internationalization. And that pretty much means you design software in a way that it can be localized properly. And that's usually an engineering task. And then the other term is localization, L10N. And that is more a business or marketing or product task, because it goes into using those things we've built in the I18N process and actually adapting software for certain markets or for certain regions or for certain times or for certain languages. And quite often that would involve actual translation work, you know, finding the right formatters to display stuff in the right context. From those two terms, it's a quick and easy jump to locales. So a locale is essentially a bundle of parameters that define what the user's expectation is in regards to language, datetime format, number format, etc. So the German expectation, for example, would be when you have a number or a currency, that it would be, you know, 14 euros and 20 cents, you would use a comma as a decimal separator. In New Zealand, you would use a dot, and the comma is used for the thousands separator. I'm not sure if in Germany the dot is actually a thing for one for the thousands. It is, right? So it's exactly flipped. But that's kind of stuff you would find in a locale. Locales are usually identified by things like a language and a region. So you might have DEDE, which is German in Germany, or you might have DECH, which is German in Switzerland. And similar stuff is true for English. You know, we have an English Australia, an English NZ, we have an English US, and there are tons of additional English locales. The bottom one is interesting, that's MINZ. Does anyone have an idea what that might be? Yeah, it's Māori, which is the indigenous language in New Zealand, and that has its own locale. Funny enough, not a lot of phones support that. I think there's actually one Huawei phone that has MINZ actually on the OEM ROM. When it comes to device locales, we will usually find that a user has at least one preferred locale set on their device. And as a fallback, there's always a device locale that is built into the ROM. And you would think that's mostly, or that's always English US, because, you know, Android comes from Google. But what you find is there are a lot of devices where the default locale is not English US, and particularly Asian manufacturers. If you look at places like companies like Oppo, for example, or those upspringing Chinese manufacturers, a lot of devices do not come with English US as the default system locale, which is really interesting and challenging in some ways. So when we actually talk about apps, and we look at, like, you know, what happens when an app starts and app loads, basically, Android will try to resolve your resources to the device's user's preferred locale. And it does that by looking for the full locale. So we might check, is there German in Germany? If that's not available, they'll try to match the language at least. And if there's nothing for the language, we would actually look for other region children of that language. And that is a very simplified process. Also good to note is that this process has changed. With Android 7, they introduced the children lookup, basically. And previously, in Android 5, or in Android 6 and previously, they would just fall back to whatever the system default locale is and not even bother looking into other children of the same language. In general, there is more that is split between Android 6 and 7. So it's kind of a bit of a tale of two worlds. In Android 6, or up to Android 6 land, the way how I18N actually works is libraries like ICU and CLDR, which are the common kind of APIs for I18N stuff in the Java world or even in other languages, are kind of exposed through the SDK, but in a very limited way. And when you actually dig through documentation, you'll find a table which ICU and CLDR versions are available by which SDK in Android. With Android 7, stuff has changed, and basically now there is a library called ICU4J, which is the common Java implementation of that ICU library, that is available, and you have way better support for a lot of those locale functionalities. I don't know how many people have actually, you know, like, apps that need to be localized into a lot of different languages, but if you do that, you can quite easily do it in Android Studio, with the translation editor. And you can see that we have a few really bizarre languages here, like Amharic, which is, I think, a language that is spoken somewhere in Africa, which you wouldn't see, you know, in many day-to-day scenarios. And then you end up getting all those string files in like value directories that are basically tagged with the language. And again, depending on how you set stuff up, you might go more granular, and you might even have like, you know, I don't know, German, Germany, German, Swiss, if you want to actually support that kind of granularity. A few general best practices for locales. In general, you don't want to hardcode text into your app, into your UI. That's always a bad idea for various reasons. The other thing is be aware that there is a difference between Android text and tools text when you actually build UI. Tools text is a way to provide some sample content in the UI editor in Android Studio that you can actually see what the text is in there. Don't use Android text for that. Different languages are usually structured in different ways. Like German is a language that has a lot of long and weird words and words with hyphens. I find French is quite similar to that as well, and Finnish in a lot of ways. Other languages have rather more words and shorter words, and that can have an impact on your UI, you know, how things render and how things fall apart potentially. And you see that across web, and you see that across native apps. It doesn't really make any difference. I've seen, like, I've made a point with some of my clients that have that kind of international setup that I actually use the German versions to build and test, because they can't be bothered. They just use English, and I need to actually find a way to show them like how bad things are broken sometimes. Be aware of word order. When you have like strings that you want to translate, in some instances, the word order will change in different languages, right? So don't concatenate strings. That's, again, one of those things that will come back and bite you usually. Then there are issues with plural sometimes. So in German, we're usually used to have like a version of a word for one thing and for many things. But there are actually other languages that have different words or different word stems for one, two, and more than two, right? And be aware of those problems that exist. If you just say like, well, I have singular and plural, you might actually screw yourself quite badly with that. Be aware of those kind of, you know, linguistic details. And the other thing, you want to provide your translators with context. There's nothing worse if you go to an outsourced translator, give them basically a bunch of strings to translate without showing them the UI and the context that stuff is used at. And then a few other general locale concerns. Obviously, we talked about the comma versus dot as separators and numbers. The position of the currency symbol, like, you know, the dollar sign or the euro sign, does it go in front of the number or behind the number? And that, surprisingly, is like all over the place. Or stuff yet, like units, you know, like the metric system versus the US, basically, because the US, for whatever reason, still can't make up their mind what they want to do, and they want to be one of the five countries in the world sticking with the imperial system, basically. Fine. All right, so that's locales. One thing that is interestingly enough, not properly defined in locales, is time and time zones. And that's a good thing to have a look into that and see why that is and where our time measurement and our time, our understanding of time actually comes from. So it pretty much started with stuff like that, right? So that's kind of a solar clock thing really early on. And you would, if you lived in the 15th, 16th century, you would basically look at the position of the sun or of the stars, and you would determine time by that. You know, if the sun is at highest point, it's kind of midday, essentially. That's fine. And we call that true solar time. That still exists. It's a thing, right? Like, if I go outside now, I can determine the true solar time of Berlin right now. And if, you know, for example, Mario would now be in Hamburg, and would do exactly the same thing in Hamburg, we would get a different solar time because in different locations, the sun is in different positions, right? You can see the problem with that, right? Because if every location has a different solar time, it's kind of bloody hard to have a shared understanding of time in the first place. So this is a mechanical kind of clock. And after people figured out that it doesn't really work with that solar time, they started to build those kind of things. And there are, again, different variations of that kind of time measurement. So we talked about the true solar time, and then people came up a bit later with a mean solar time. So you would basically say for example, the German region, we want to define a mean solar time, which is an average position of the sun, to figure out what time it is in Germany right now. Again, that has its pros and cons and problems. One of the issues with solar time is that the solar days are not of the same length, and the mean solar time actually fixes that. One thing that triggered a massive change was the railways. So in on this thing here, it's basically a photograph of an old railway and distance travel table. We can see that, let me just find that here, from Berlin to Hanover, the normal travel time, and that's how they measured that, measured it then, would be 32 hours. So that would be probably by horse carriage or something like that. And then with the introduction of rail, that travel time came down to 10 hours and 10 minutes, which is still a shocker, given that we do that in 1.5 hours nowadays on the ICE train, right? But that's like basically a third of the time that was necessary before. Now, the reason why rail changed everything when it comes to time is basically because when people traveled by horse or by horse carriage, it wouldn't really matter. You know, if you were traveling from, I don't know, let's say, Barcelona to Berlin to visit the German Kaiser or something like that, it would take you 2 weeks anyway. You know, why do you, would you care about the, an hour and time difference depending on the sun? It's like, yeah, not really worth it, right? But all of a sudden, if your train ride kind of shrinks that time to something that is maybe a few hours, you start to notice those inconsistencies in time way more. And that's really why the introduction of railways and railroads changed time measurement significantly. People wanted timetables. You know, they wanted to know when you came to the station, the train would leave at 6 o'clock. And when it arrived, let's say, in Nuremberg or something like that, it would arrive at 7:30, basically. So people came up with concepts like the Greenwich Mean Time. So that's what we know as GMT, and that's probably a term that you would have heard as a developer at some point, you know, GMT or GMT plus 7 or something like that. The GMT is actually a local solar time. Greenwich is a suburb of London, a bit south of London, actually, and they have an observatory there. And so they basically said, like, the time here, that's what we want to use for the local railway companies in the UK. So basically, that's what's called railroad time, essentially. So they started using GMT, and they gave all their conductors portable chronometers, like, you know, those mechanical clocks in a bit smaller, but still, like, massive compared to, like, watches now, obviously. And they used GMT as a as the time the UK would use for their railroads. And that's really one of the first time zones that we actually find in history. Then in the 1860s, New Zealand got colonized at some point by the British, and we introduced the New Zealand Mean Time, which was GMT plus 1130. Why not? Yeah, 1130 makes perfect sense. Let's do that. In the 1860s up to the 1890s, in the US, railroad time was introduced. And because the US is so huge, they had like 4 different time zones. When you look, and we'll see that in a few minutes, when you look at the actual time zone map of the US today, we still have those 4 big time zones, funny enough. So that has not changed at all. On a more global level, there was a movement to introduce a global system of time zones. pretty close to what we know now, basically, right? And there was an Italian guy, a mathematician, and he suggested, we want a 24-hour time, that would be useful, and let's focus the time system on Rome, because that's where the Pope lives and where the Catholic Church is. And the majority of people said, like, nah, let's not do that. Let's just stick with GMT, because we have the Greenwich time system, and the British were really, you know, big and important back then, basically, so they actually managed to push GMT as the basis of the time system that we know now. Around the early 1900s, you can probably say that most of the Earth had some sort of a standard time zone. They were not necessarily in brackets of 1 hour. And I'll explain in a minute why the 1 hour is actually a nice round thing. Today, we have time zones which are like a full hour, half hour, and 15 minutes. And before you say, like, why the hell would you do that? There are good reasons for that. And again, we'll see that in a few minutes. What we generally find is politics play a huge part in time zones. And that's kind of a shocker, because it should really be driven by geography and by the needs of the people and not by political players making moves, but that's unfortunately what it is. Let's have a look at that map again. So if you look at this, we have the Greenwich GMT time zone somewhere here. And it actually also is what's called the zero meridian. So meridians are the degrees of longitude. If you think of the Earth as a globe, as a ball, which it is not, but you know, just for sake of use, a perfect ball, you'll find that the perfect ball has 360 degrees. If we want to have 24 time zones, it means like each time zone spans 15 degrees of longitude. And that kind of works out in a lot of cases. We'll see a few really weird things, right? Like, look here, what's that little dent up there? Or what is going on here in the Pacific, where I come from? There's a lot of crazy stuff. And then, you know, here in Southeast Asia, clearly the geographical time zones don't quite match what is reality. And let's come back to that in a second. So we talked about GMT. I said GMT is the mean solar time at the meridian passing through that Royal Observatory in Greenwich. That's basically the zero point. And then we have UTC. And a lot of people say, like, UTC is exactly the same as GMT, just another word for it, blah, blah, blah. It's not. GMT is a mean solar time based on observation. You look at the sun or at the stars, or you look in the sky in general. UTC is an atomic time, like a modern version of time measurement, that is guaranteed to be always within 0.9 seconds of GMT, and it's doing that by adding leap seconds to it. Because the problem is, we're not a perfect globe. And a day is not exactly 24 hours. And to cater for that, we have to kind of deal with those leap seconds. UTC is also known as Zulu time, if you heard that term before. Again, I'll show you in a second why that is. Fun fact, because the Earth's rotation is slowing, we will need more and more leap seconds in the future. It's not stopping, basically. It's, yeah, more of that is necessary. Let's have a look at that thing. Yeah, that's one of the sad elements of time zone management. So here we've got the international dateline, that little black zigzag line. And I'm showing you the northern hemisphere part of that currently, right? So somewhere here is the equator, basically. And you can clearly see that is not a straight line at all, right? So the international dateline is kind of an imaginary line in the Pacific Ocean. It was set up in 1884 by a international meridian conference. So important countries of the time got together, and they tried to figure out what do we do with the, you know, time system, basically. And they figured we need to have that international dateline because we can't really make it work properly to have a continuous flow of time. There must be a breakpoint somewhere. So when you actually cross the IDL and you go from east to west, like from North America to Oceania or to Asia, you basically add a day instantly, and when you go from west to east, you subtract a day, right? Really weird when you do that the first time, and you come from Australia or New Zealand, you end up in the US, and it's like earlier before you left. It's one of those little bizarre things. The IDL is based on the 180-degree meridian, so it's exactly the opposite of the zero-degree meridian. You can actually, and I find that really cool, you can mathematically prove that we need to have the international dateline. There is actually a theorem called the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, and if you apply that to a one-dimensional space, you end up with this. It's a topological fact that there does not exist any continuous one-to-one function mapping from a circle to an interval. That's exactly why we need that date timeline. It has no practical use for any of you, but it's really a cool mathematical little side note thing. Here we've got the international dateline in a historic point of view, in a historic map. That's from the 1840s. And it's really weird. Look at that, that big bump here. And that's because the Philippines were on the American side of the international dateline in the 1840s. God knows why. Probably some colonial reason. And it just meant like, yeah, we have that, you know, huge bump here, whatever. You know, no concept of trying to have a straight line at all. Coming back to time formats in Zulu time. So if you have that, you know, 9:30 UTC, for example, we usually express that at 9:30 Z for Zulu or just 0930Z without the separator. So stuff like, you know, quarter to three and a few seconds UTC, you would quite often express as a six-digit figure with a Z. That's the shortest variation of doing that. And then we've got stuff like offsets to express in which time zone of UTC someone might be, plus 3, plus 300, or plus minus 03. Terminology like, you know, MEST or NZDT or BST for British Standard Time or British Summer Time or something like that, they are all made up by countries. They are not internationally defined and standardized. So don't ever believe any of that, basically. It's just some people in a country thinking, I want to give that thing a name. There's no global directory that makes sure that NZDT is unique globally. The Zulu time thing comes actually from the US Navy. Interesting side note. So they have a map with all the time zones, and they basically put characters or letters to the time zones. And the Greenwich Meridian time zone here is the Zulu time, and that's why we call UTC Zulu time nowadays. And they obviously use that kind of notation for military and Navy purposes. To give you another idea of the weird different time formats you sometimes get, this is a thing called a NOTAM, a Notice to Airmen. So when you fly and you're a pilot, you get those, you know, really brief messages that explain certain problems that might just happen and might affect your flight planning. So this is a notice from Wellington, actually, where they're doing some light changes on the taxiway at Wellington Airport. Doesn't really matter. But if we decode that, basically, and go through it step by step, at the beginning, it's just some introductory text, like, you know, this is a NOTAM with that number 83819. It replaces a different one, not relevant. Then the second line, it says, this is valid for New Zealand, and it comes from the NBO, which is the National Briefing Office, and then there's some other, you know, stuff behind it. But the third one is interesting, because here it says, like, this affects Wellington, NZWN is the Wellington Airport, and then B and C are actually times or date formats. So that's what's called a 10-digit format, and it essentially says, this is for the year 2018, 23rd of June from 1919, from like 19 past 7. That's the issue date, and that is the date when this is going to invalid, 2018, 24th of June, 1800. And the EST, for the Americans among you, doesn't mean Eastern Standard Time or something like that. That's actually short for estimated. So they're doing some construction work on the runway, and they estimate it to be finished roughly at 1800, but all those times are in Zulu times, even though that's valid for New Zealand. So if you actually pilot there, you have to, you know, do the mental calculation and think about, ah, okay, so that's 1800. That means it's, I don't know, 5 o'clock in the morning for me, something like that. So you find a lot of professional industries have their own kind of time set up. Daylight savings time. That occurs when, you know, like countries decide to change their clock an hour back or an hour forwards to make more use of the available sunlight. Germany has Sommerzeit and Winterzeit. You find daylight savings in a lot of countries, but they move into weird directions sometimes. So, yeah, don't even try to fully understand that, but we'll get to a few of the implications of that in a second. Lord Howe, that's a little island in the Pacific, has a DST of 30 minutes only, so they don't even do a full hour. In JVM land, all those time zones are tracked in a thing called the TZ database. And essentially, that's a text file that you can process. And I'll show you the text file in the next slide. In the JVM, it's built in. It has all sorts of historic and current time zone information. And it looks something like that. So it has a huge collection of rules that is really hard to manually read and manually process. The problem with that is that actually gets out of date quite quickly. Because time zones change and DST rules change. So on the back end, if you do Java-based stuff, for example, you would get different time zone data versions in different versions of your JRE. So here, we can see like one of the first releases of Java 6 came with like a 2008 version of time zone data. The current version of Java 6, I was amazed that they still update that, came with a 2018 version of the time zone data. You can patch that, and it's really easy and cool to do that if you have control over your server. In Android land, it's a bit difficult, right? Because we don't have control over all our devices. So let's have a look what can happen when you don't have proper time zone data. Australia. Three time zones, West Australia, Center, and East Australia, basically. Actually, it's not true. Some people came up with a thing called the Australian Central Western Time. It's this thing here, EUCLA. It's, and you wouldn't believe it, five little settlements in the desert that basically said, like, screw you, Australia. We don't want to be in the Perth time zone anymore because we are way closer to Central Australia anyway. We don't like you. We just make up our own time zone. So they put a sign on the highway, this is the new time zone, done, right? Not official, recognized by the government, but that's how things work, you know? People just do their own thing. North America. You see the four major time zones I spoke about earlier. And what you might not know is they sometimes cross states. So you have in Oregon two time zones, or in Nebraska, or in North and South Dakota. What is actually even worse, they sometimes cross counties. That's like a Landkreis in Germany. It's just outright bizarre why people would do that. This is an interesting one. That's a little island in the Baltic Sea. Yeah, right? You look at it and you think, oh, what the hell? That is possibly the world's smallest multi-time zone location, at least the one I could find, basically. I don't know. People do weird things. And then we have this. This is actually a beautiful country called Samoa in the South Pacific. And let's have a quick look at that map. And I know I'm running a bit short on time. I'll try to speed it up a little bit. So here we've got the international dateline. Here's New Zealand. We're fine. Samoa is up here. It's clearly on the... Oh, here we go. Sorry, on the American side of the date timeline. And there are a few other islands up here, Kiribati and Tokelau. That is 2010. This is now. Spot the difference. Can anyone see it? Samoa is now on the New Zealand side of the international date timeline. And American Samoa is on the American side, which makes perfect sense. So Samoa seems to have moved. Can they? I don't know. So they surely haven't moved the island, so something else has changed, right? So Samoa decided to skip the 30th of December 2011 and move the international date timeline and just cross it. And the reason for that is purely business. It's a bit hard to see from a color point of view, unfortunately, but the first two columns here, that area, is actually green on my screen. So the problem is, in the old setup where Samoa was on the American side of the date timeline, they pretty much had hardly any overlap to do business with Australia and New Zealand. And those are their main business partners and tourist destinations. Like, tourists go to the Pacific Islands to have a beach holiday, basically. So with that setup, you would find stuff like, you know, on their Monday, it was our Tuesday. Or even worse, on their Sunday, it was our Monday. And Samoa is a very Christian and religious country where literally nothing happens on a Sunday but church. Nothing. Literally. So people from New Zealand would call, you know, on their Monday thinking like, oh, it's just like a two-hour flight away. Let's just call them, and it's like impossible to do anything, basically. So the overlap is really short. And then what they did is switch the day timeline and ended up being on our side, which means like to New Zealand, we have now 5 days of overlap, where it's just like 1 hour difference, and that's fine, that's easy. And even to Australia, you know, it's 3 hour difference, and that's easy to manage. And that problem with like disturbing their Sunday is gone as well, basically, right? So they did that. Also, funny enough, it's the second big change for Samoa, because they used to drive on the right-hand side of the road, like Germany, and they changed that to drive on the left-hand side of the road in 2009 to cater for all the Australian New Zealand tourists who said, like, what the hell, why do I have to drive on the right side? And the history is Samoa used to be a German colony. Who knew, right? And that's why they had right-hand side driving. It's just, like, crazy. And the islands of Tokelau followed that move because they thought, that's actually cool, we do that as well. Samoa was so proud about that, they actually produced, like, stamps, like, Samoa official first day cover. You know, it's like amazing. They were so happy that they could participate on our side of the world. So like totally loved it. And then we've got like a similar scenario in Kiribati, and I'll just jump through that. Here's the weird little thing. Like, see how that date timeline is broken here? So they even have a plus 14 time zone, because that bit that is in plus 14 used to be in minus 10. So they had like the country of Kiribati spread across 2 days. And people, you think like, what are they thinking, you know? So that got fixed in the 1990s, roughly. So that is much better now, compared to what it used to be, at least. There are a bunch of other oddities, like Russia is doing crazy stuff with time zones, like they jump back and forth, they get rid of time zones, they introduce new ones. Just recently, North Korea switched time. In the wake of the whole, you know, Trump goes to meet Kim Jong, basically, wake up. North Korea used to have like plus 8:30 time, and they switched to the South Korean time, most likely as a sign of good political goodwill, to kind of, you know, approach their former enemies, essentially. And before, I'll just jump through those two. Before I finish, quick word on Android. So I said already, like, you can't update the time zone data in Android in any easy way, because it's baked into the OS. We have to rely on hardware manufacturer updates. That's, yeah, let's just move on, basically, not going to happen. The additional problem is date and calendar in most of the Java versions that we have are challenging to deal with, not really great. So the best options you have are actually using Yoda time, respectively Yoda time for Android, or 310BP, that's a backport library of the JSR 310 libraries, to make that available for older versions of the JVM. Respectively, you want to use 310ABP, which is an Android variation of that. And those Android variation exists because of issues with loading JARs into the Android ecosystem. So I would, you know, suggest any of those. In general, good practices, if you can, manage as much as you can in UTC. If you build a greenfield project that doesn't require really local time zones, build all the communication in UTC and make the presentation layer responsible for actually rendering the local time zones. There are exceptions, For example, when you do like alarm clocks or scheduling stuff in general, you might have to deal with time zones in Android because you want to make sure that they actually pop up at the right time. Questions like what happens if the user travels and changes time zones? What if the user's time zone information is wrong in the first place? So like a few days ago, I had a chat to someone at a dinner here, and they said like they had huge issues with time zones because lots of their users had the right time on the phone, but the time zone was set to Hong Kong or something like that. It's like, yeah, well, if people do that, that whole nice planning just goes out of your window right away, basically. And that's, you know, one of the disadvantages of that kind of working. So, and just finally, coming back to the Mario Kart problem, I can't obviously fix that. I can't force Nintendo to do it right, and I know it's most likely still not fixed. So what we have to do, and that's like my invitation and my friends in the first row, on 30th of September, and then on the 7th of October, and on the 28th of October, our global Mario Kart tournament is going to break. And that's only based on the players that we have now, which are in Germany, Australia, and New Zealand. Because of this. Because we move time zones in one direction, and then they move into the other direction, and Australia is doing something completely different. And it's basically all messed up. And I have no way of fixing it, which is really, really sad. But that's just what it is sometimes with, like, you know, international development, international time zones. One quick shout out, if you play Mario Kart and if you want to participate in our tournament, here's the tournament code, and I can give it to you privately after the session as well, if you like. A bunch of resources, some of the links are pointing to stuff I mentioned, some of the links are just general information, like there's a really good article about time zones in room, for instance, if you want to do that kind of stuff. So, you know, just go through them and have a bit of a play. And with that, I'm eventually finished. Sorry that I overran like 4 minutes. Thanks a lot for listening anyway. If you have any questions, I'll take them outside to get out of the way of the next speaker as quickly as possible. Thanks a lot.